Before we move on to the next speaker, I'd like for you to give an applause to the volunteers who made this happen, namely Andreas and Cem, and also our technicians. Okay, thanks. In the back. This is a non-profit event, and this is basically organized by Miles and me, and the program has been selected by a program committee, which is very small, and in essence, it's, so we do that because we like it, and if you like it, then there's nothing stopping you from getting involved, or with type level in general. So if you want to get involved with type level in general, you just go to typelevel.org, and then you click on the list of projects, and then you scroll through a list of projects, of which there are 47, and find one of them where you would like to contribute to. So if you want to see this kind of thing happening more often in the future, or keep happening, then we need you to contribute and maybe consider sponsoring an event that's upcoming. We don't have any summit upcoming, but there will be workshops happening at Scala World, and there will be an unconference happening at Lambda World, and potentially some other world events. I don't know. Are there other world events?
No.
there really should be a functional programming world. Or I don't know. type world. Right, so this is to repeat myself, do get involved. So that would be really cool. So our next speaker, Zainab, is that correct? Okay, yeah. She's coming from London, and I'm so happy she actually made it here because her flight got cancelled yesterday, but she came anyway. was able to rebook to a flight today. And just as another speaker today, she's also a physicist. So apparently Scala is really popular with physicists. I don't know why, but is it because you're a physicist that you're interested in dimensional analysis?
Yeah, it is.
Okay, well then, please have a warm welcome for Zainab, who is going to talk about Libra and dependent types.
Hello everyone, I'm really glad that I managed to make it today and I'm so pleased to give this talk to you. I know it's the last talk of the day, but I think we're probably going to wrap up a lot of the subjects that we've covered today with Libra, so I'm really glad that I can talk about it. Okay, so we're going to cover dependent types, and so I just want a quick show of hands, who's heard of dependent types before? Oh, this is going to be great, I don't need to tell you anything, that's absolutely fantastic. Okay. Who was kind of interested in the talk that Aaron gave earlier today about type class induction? Yeah, you have to say that, right? You love that. It was great. Okay, so we're going to kind of build on that with Libra. We're going to build on quite a few of the things that we've discussed today and also use type level Scala in this. So please pay attention. It's going to be really nice. Okay, so what is Libra? So you've probably heard of Libra in some way, you know, maybe you know that Libra is the Latin name for weighing scales or balance. This was, you know, centuries ago it meant that. And it also meant the name of a constellation and a star sign, so some of you might be Libras yourself, in which case, you know, this talk is for you. Definitely pay attention. But more recently, as of this year, Libra has come to known as a dimensional analysis library. And that's what I'm going to be talking to you about today. Also, a little bit about the other Libras. So, what is dimensional analysis? Now, I mentioned earlier, right, I'm a physicist, and dimensional analysis is a concept in physics that's really interesting, because I would say that what quantifies a physicist is that physicists deal with things, right, as opposed to mathematicians who deal with concepts and numbers. Physicists deal with those too, but we also deal with real-world quantities, and often when we're solving a problem, we deal with those too. For example, you know, I could come up with a number of the number of people in this room, And maybe in my code that might be a double or an int or a float, but really it represents the number of people, right? And I could also talk about the number of chairs in this room, and that would also be double int or float. Really should be an int, that one, right? Don't want a half a person or half a chair here. But, you know, if I added the number of people in this room to the number of chairs together, the result that I would get would be nonsensical. It wouldn't make any sense. If I did that in my code, it would probably be a bug that I would get. But I could take the number of people and divide that by the number of chairs, and what I would get is some kind of a measure of how full this talk was. And that would be useful. And so dimensional analysis is just a way of encoding those rules. It's basically saying that, well, if I have something, I should only be able to add it to something else of that same dimension, right? I should only be able to add people and people together. I shouldn't be able to add people and chairs. That doesn't make sense. But what I can do is that I can multiply or divide quantities of different dimensions. I can take a number of people and divide that by number of chairs, and that makes sense. And so dimensional analysis, it sounds like a quite complicated term, but what it's doing is really something that we all know about and we all do. Well, I say we all do it, but in reality, we probably don't, right? When we actually write our code and we do computation, we just work in doubles, ints, floats, whatever type works for us. And we often don't pay attention to the actual dimensions that they are, apart from maybe when we name things. And, you know, we've got by doing that. But it's really important that we actually consider the dimensions, because stuff can go wrong, right? And this is an example of the Mars Climate Orbiter. You may have heard of this one. This in the, I think, late 1990s, there was a huge Mars orbiter launch, and it was sent to Mars, and it was going to do some really amazing stuff, get really amazing data, and it got there, and everyone was really excited, but suddenly it just crashed into the Martian atmosphere and was completely destroyed. And when people went and, you know, did an analysis of why this happened, they actually found out that, well, the Mars orbiter itself was working correctly. Most of the components in it were working in metric units. NASA always work in metric units. Most of us should be working in metric units too. But there was one tiny component on that Mars orbiter which was working in imperial units. It was working in feet and pounds and inches. And talking to all the other components, and of course they didn't know what to make of that. You know, they took those metrics and it just crashed into Mars. And, you know, this was a huge mission, right? So much money was lost there. And this bug really should have been caught earlier, right? We all know in development that we try and catch bugs. If we have to, we catch them at runtime, right? We do runtime validation. We check that those values that we get from something are accurate. If we can't do runtime validation, or rather along with that, we also do testing, right? If we were doing this, right, we would simulate this launch beforehand, and so we would catch that this thing would happen in the testing stage. It would never actually get there. But wouldn't it be really cool if we could actually catch this kind of bug at compile time, so that when we compiled our code, we would get an error saying that your code is wrong, and we couldn't actually deploy that? That would be really fantastic. And that is what Libra tries to achieve. Okay, so we are going to go to try and get compile-time dimensional analysis. It's a long road. What we're going to try and do is apply this to a rocket launch. Not quite the same as the Mars orbiter. We're going to be a bit more adventurous than that. We're going to go all the way to Libra. So we're going to try and launch a rocket to Libra and see what happens. We're going to cover quite a few topics here. So we're going to start with doubles, just like we always work with, see how that goes. We're going to slowly introduce some types and type logic here, and we're going to go through dependent types. And we're also going to do, we're going to introduce type level Scala, which is something that's quite new, which you've probably not worked with before, but it's really interesting. And we're going to do some type pass induction, which we've already seen earlier today. We're going to do a bit more of it. And then finally, we'll have finally made Libra. So let's hope that we can get through all that. Okay, so first of all, our case study, we're going to go to Alpha Libra, which is one of the main stars in Libra. It's 77 light years away. We're only going to take one very small person because it's a very long distance, so only someone 40 kilograms, you'll probably have to slim down a bit. Yeah, so we've got some fuel there, 10,000 kilograms of fuel. It sounds like a lot, but NASA have this, don't worry. We're a bit optimistic about the exhaust speed, you know, 1 million meters per second. We could probably do that, that's all right. And the question that we want to ask here is, when will we get there? right? We're sending off this person, and, you know, we want to know when they're going to arrive, right? So we're going to use a very simple equation for this. This is called the Tsiolkovsky rocket equation. It's really easy to derive if you like physics. It's very simple, based on the conservation of momentum. But what it does, right, is that it just says, okay, we have some starting mass, which is our rocket mass plus our fuel mass. We have the mass that we end up with, which is just our rocket mass because we've evicted all our fuel. We divide one by the other, right? We take the log of that, and we multiply it by our exhaust speed, which is our fuel speed. And what we get at the end is our rocket speed. So you don't necessarily need to know how this equation works, but this is the thing that we need to use to calculate our time. And we do that just very simply by taking the distance we're going to go and dividing that by the speed, and we get a time. Okay, so first of all, let's just plug the numbers in, right? I mean, we work with doubles, let's work with doubles here. So we add our masses together, add 40 kilograms to 10,000, divide that by 40 because that's what we end up with. We get the rocket speed from that, and then we've got 77 light years, that's how far we're going. Divide that by the rocket speed, and you know, we get this amazing value, right, of 1 times 10 to the minus 5. And you know what that means, right, is that we can get to Libra in less than a day. And that is absolutely amazing, right? You know, you're going to be there by nightfall. Except, of course, you know, that's not realistic, right? Something's obviously gone wrong. We've made a mistake here. And I could go through this code slowly and painfully and try and figure out where that was. But instead of doing that, you know, I want to catch this at compile time. So I'm going to see what I can do to make the compiler catch this bug. So let's start with using types and see how we go. So instead of just using our basic double, what we're going to do is wrap this in a quantity case class. And this quantity doesn't really do anything, but we've put a type parameter in there called A. And that type parameter is not instantiated here, but it just provides some additional information. So these are some possible values of what that type might be. It might be kilogram, if we're working in kilograms. It might be meters per second, if we're working in that. Maybe we want to do the speed of light c. Maybe we want to say it's light years, or maybe a year. It's important to note that we don't ever instantiate this, right? These are types. They're not values, right? We don't get an instance of a kilogram. This is just a type kilogram. So let's see how we might use this. What we're doing is that we're just annotating all of our values that we had with type. So we're now saying we've got 40 kilograms, 10,000 kilograms. We've got our exhaust speed in meters per second now. And we're doing exactly the same calculation. You know, we're now typing it, though, with our type. But just putting the types in hasn't actually helped. It might mean that we now can read it better, but it's not solved our bug. The reason being is that we've put these types in, but the compiler hasn't done anything with them yet. There's nothing that it's done. And so what we need to do is try and make it such that the compiler can now use these types to work out what to do. So first of all, let's just start with our quantity case class we had before. Now, remember that our first rule of dimensional analysis was that we could only add things to other things of the same dimension. So that's a pretty easy one to encode, because we just have an add method. And what we say is that if I've got a quantity, I can only add that to quantities of the same dimension. So provided that I use this add method, I'll only be able to add quantities of the same dimension. If I try and add meters and seconds together, this now won't work. So that's really good. We've got our first rule. We also need to times by some other value, and this is possible in dimensional analysis. You should be able to times by some value which is dimensionless, and what you should get is a quantity of the dimension that you initially had, right? So I can take 5 meters and multiply that just by 5 of no dimension, I'd get 25 meters. But what about when we divide? So for example, let's say that I have meters, I should be able to divide meters by second and get meters per second. But I should also be able to divide meters by kilograms and get meters per kilogram. So our divide is really strange, because what we want to say is that I should be able to take a quantity of any other dimension and divide that, and I'll get some quantity out of some dimension, which is kind of magical, right? If I divide meters by second, I get meters per second, but then if I divide meters by kilograms, meters per kilogram, those two are different things. And so We kind of know what they are because we understand the rules of dimensional analysis, but our compiler doesn't. So how do we tell the compiler what this magical type is? And really, what we mean to say is that this type that we get out, this magic type, is dependent on this type B, right? You know, I have meters divided by seconds, I get meters per second. That's dependent on seconds. And in the same sense, if I have kilograms over there, it will be meters per kilogram dependent on kilograms. And so what we really want to say is that we want dependent types. We want to say that if I've got some type A and some type B, and you know I'm dividing A by B, the thing that I get out is dependent on what A and B originally were. And so this is what a dependent type really is. So what we want to do is actually have a divide type class of A and B, which has a dependent type out here. And you've all said you know what they are, so I won't go into more detail here, but we can see that we've got a dependent type. We also need some way of referring to that output type, so we create something called an aux here. This is the aux pattern. You'll see it a lot when you're using dependent types. Okay, so how do we actually use this divide type class? So we have some quantity of type B, and what we're actually looking for is a divide type class of A and B, and the quantity that we get is of type out, right? It's of the output type of what our divide type class was. And what we really mean here is that we provide types A and types B, you know, we'd provide meters and seconds, and the compiler would then go and find this implicit type class instance, and it would then find this output type. So we're telling the compiler, you know, go find this output type. And then that's really useful because now we actually have an output type to work with. And we can perform a division as such. So let's write some of these type class instances out. We'll just write them manually for now, right? So if I have a kilogram and I divide a kilogram by a kilogram, I get something which is dimensionless. If I have a light year and I divide it by C, then I get something which is in years. And I can keep going and do this with all my dimensions, right? If I have a light year and I divide it by meters per second, I get light years seconds per meter. And we're kind of seeing that, okay, if we keep doing this, we'll have to write loads and loads and loads of implicit type class instances. In fact, we'll have to write an infinite number of type class instances to support all our use cases. But okay, let's just write those and see how we work with them. So now we are doing the same thing, right? We've typed our quantities, and we're using our add that we had before to add rocket mass and fuel mass together. That works, that's good, right? And now what we have is that we have divided, using our divide here, we're dividing distance by rocket speed, and we're saying that we expect years out, because we were thinking our time was going to be in years. And now the compiler has picked up this error, right? And it's telling us, no, we've got a type mismatch here. It's found light years seconds per meter here. It's not got years. So the compiler is now telling us the bug that we made, right? And it's fixing it for us, so that's absolutely wonderful. We're already there. But like I said before, you know, we needed to write out this implicit type class instance for every single combination of types that we had. And you know, that's just not feasible. It just doesn't scale. And so, you know, there's too much boilerplate. And what can we use to get rid of all this boilerplate? And so we're going to turn to shapeless here because, you know, we know that when we have boilerplate, shapeless is the tool to use. So this is how we're going to use it. We're going to create base dimensions, and if you've worked with dimensional analysis, you know that often you do have base dimensions, like your SI units are base dimensions. And the dimensions that we're going to define here are light years, years, meters, and seconds. And what we can then say is that we can create a H list, or a type level list, to represent combinations of these dimensions. So if I had something that was in light year seconds, I could represent this as a H list of light year and then seconds. And this is a bit like a list on the type level. But let's say that I wanted to now represent meters per second. I can't do that just using a normal H list because now what I need to do is represent exponents, right? I need to say I've got meters to the power of 1, seconds to the power of minus 1. So now we need to do something that's a bit more complicated. And so what we're going to turn to help us out here is actually type level Scala. because Type Level Scala has a really cool feature in it called literal types. Now, do you all know what Type Level Scala is?
Yes.
Oh, okay, so only a few hands. All right, but this is the Type Level Summit, right? Wait, okay, I need to tell you guys. So, Type Level Scala is the type level fork of the Scala compiler. I'm sure Miles can tell you loads and loads about it, and would really love if you guys contributed as well. And what it has, right, is that it's got some fixes, some changes from the normal Scala compiler, which will soon be merged into the Scala compiler. So you shouldn't think of the type level Scala as something that's completely different. You don't want to use it, right? What you should see it as is almost changes which will be included in the Scala compiler later, but for your use early on. And so to include it, you set your Scala organization to org.typeLevel, and the thing that we're going to use that type level Scala gives us is literal types. And what literal types allow us to do is that they allow us to use singleton types in a type position like this. So, I mean, I could say values in a type position, but that wouldn't be quite accurate. So what we wanted to do is represent exponents, right? And when we say exponents, we mean almost integer numbers. And what literal types allow us to do is that they allow us to say that now we have a number which is an integer, and if we know this number at compile time, what we can say is that this number itself is actually a type. What we're saying is that over here, I've got the type 1, which is a subtype of int. So this number 1 here is not a value, it's a type. And so we're using numbers or integers as types. The other thing that I've got here is that I've got a field type. And a field type is just a key value pair that you can get from shapeless. Because what we now want to do is represent a key value pair of some dimension and some exponent. Right? So we're saying that to represent meters per second, we have meters to the power of 1, seconds to the power of minus 1, and as a H list. And the other thing we need to do is that, you know, we've got this really cool feature from type level Scala, but we want to be able to manipulate these exponents now. So what we're going to use is a library called SingletonOps. SingletonOps is based, it also uses type level Scala, and it provides operations for these singleton types. So with SingletonOps, you can add these types together. So it says that if I add the type 1 to the type 2, I get the type 3. Right? If I multiply the type 3 by the type 2, I get the type 6. Incidentally, you can also get the values out of these as well using type level Scala. There's a type class called valueOf which allows you to get the actual value if you want to use that at runtime. So another nice thing that singleton types provides us with is this handy shorthand for the for singleton with int. So what this is that we're saying that we have some type here, let's say 3, which is a singleton type, and it's also an integer, it's a subtype of this. So 3 would be a subtype of xint. Okay, now we're going to go on to do some induction. Because remember what we really wanted to do was that we wanted to scrap our boilerplate and say, instead of having to write out all our type class instances, we now want to derive them. And we're going to derive them using induction. So we're going to derive type class instances for three different things, for invert, for multiply and divide. And divide was the one that we wanted to use, but we're going to do invert and multiply to help us get us there. So invert is a type class. It looks the same as divide almost. We're saying that we have some dimension A, or some, now it's going to be a H list of dimensions. And so what I want to do is say that I've got this H list of dimensions. I want to invert it and get another H list out. And so, for example, I might say that I've got a field type, H list of meters to the 1. I invert it to get meters to the minus 1, right? So I do this using induction. I say that I've got a base case, which is my nil case. I say if I've got an empty H list and I invert that, I get an empty H list out. On the other hand, if I've got a H list which is not empty, it looks a little more complicated. And the way that you read these is that you should always look at what the return type is. Because what I'm saying here is that I've got some H list which has a head of dimension D and some exponent and some other tail, and I'm returning a H list which has dimension D but negating that exponent and having an output tail. And the way that I'm doing that is I'm using singleton ops to negate my exponent for me, and I'm saying that I want evidence that that tale has already been inverted. So that tale would have been inverted maybe by the ghost case, maybe by another recursive case as well. And so I can do the same for multiply. For multiply, I say I've got type A and B, and I multiply them together and get some output type. And so I might say I've got meters and meters. I multiply those together to get meters squared. Now, the base case is quite simple. You know, I've got some list on the right. I multiply that by h-nil on the left, and I get that list on the right. The recursive case is slightly more complicated. But, you know, it's also fairly trivial. You know, we've got some list on the right, some list on the left. So to describe what I'm doing here, right, what we want to do is say that if I've got a list on the left, take the head of that list and go and try and find an element of that, select an element from the list on the right. So let's say I've got meters as the head, go look for meters on the right list. So to give an example, let's say I'm multiplying meters to the power of 3 by meters to the power of 2. I'd go pluck 2 from my right list, because I'd go look at meters and get the 2 out. Then what I'm going to do is add those together. 2 plus 3 is 5. And that is what is going to be in my output exponent here. And, you know, the reason why we did that, it looked all really complicated, but the reason why we did that is that if we can invert, and if we can multiply, then it becomes a lot easier to divide. Because all we need to say, right, is that if I've got some list on the left and some list on the right, I want to divide the left by the right, I just invert the right and then multiply them together. So what I'm actually doing is just building on the work that we've already done to make a very, very simple type class instance. And so we don't need to, you know, do all the induction again, because we've already done it using the things that we've done so far. Okay, let's try and go and use this. So we put this in, and we say that we've got kilograms. So now we have to write it as a h-list. We've got mass, we write that as a h-list too. Our exhaust speed is a little more complicated because it's meters to the power of 1, seconds to the minus 1. And our distance is also light years to the 1. And so what we expect to get is years to the 1, right? And you know, we get the same error. It's a little more complicated because our signature is more complicated, but it's actually caught it, which is great, right? We haven't had to write out all our instances. It's done it for us. But, you know, this is kind of complicated to actually read, so let's make it a bit simpler. And the way that we do that is that we add some polish, right? We're pimping up our double now. We're saying, let's add these methods onto our double to easily get from a double to a quantity in light years and kilograms and years and meters per second. We might as well add some operators while we're at it. So what we actually end up with is something that looks very similar to what we started with, right? But what we actually get now is that we get our type-safe dimensional analysis. So, you know, we're using these ops that we've defined to say this thing is now in kilograms, right? We are saying this thing is now in meters per second. We're actually fixing our bug in this one as well, because we're saying, okay, let's have now a speed conversion from meters per second to C. And now what we get out is a time, and our time is now in years. And the time that we get is now much more accurate, right? It's over 4,000 years, so this is looking correct. I'm sorry, we can't really send you. That's what we figured out. But you know, it really looks similar to what we started with, right? It's only a little bit extra. And so, you know, we've reached Libra. We've actually done it in...
I still don't get how you get from light per second to meters.
Oh, sure, we can go through it, right? So we've got a speed conversion, which is in meters per second to C. C is the speed of light. Yeah, okay. So if we now divide by that speed conversion, yeah, we get our quantity in years. So that's fixing it now. This one at the bottom is wrong. Okay, so we do this now. So we've covered dependent types, we've used type level Scala, and we've used singleton ops as well to help us. And we've done some type class induction. And you know, that was really hard, right? It took the whole day to learn about this, but yeah, we finally got there. You know, we've done this, but actually, if you want to use it, you don't actually does this for you. It gives you this compile-time dimensional analysis, and also lets you roll your own dimensions. So to just make that apparent, right? The only custom code that you have to write to apply this to a problem of rocket physics is you define your dimensions as types, and you write some ops on double or whatever type you want to use, right? And that's all you need to write yourself to use it. And everything else that we've written is library code. So, to give an example, right? Let's say that you, like me, were also coming from the UK, coming to Denmark, and you wanted to convert your currency, right? And you wanted to make sure that you got the right figure. Maybe you would actually use currencies as types. Say, okay, I've got krona, I've got GBP. Maybe I want to know my exchange rate from krona to GBP. And I want to find out how much krona I'll get if I have £10. And we can now apply this, right? We can use dimensional analysis to make sure that we are doing the right exchange. And so if you want to use this in your own projects, Libra is part of the type level incubator, and you can take a look at this URL. So check it out. Okay.
I just want to say thank you. That's absolutely awesome. I've wanted to do this for years, and always was put off by the thought that actually it's going to be really quite fiddly to do, and there's going to be lots of fiddly stuff to do. But I must say, I think you made that look very, very, very straightforward and simple. Congratulations. I think it's great stuff.
Firstly, again, that was amazing. Well done. Do you have to be using type level compiler yourself? Not type level. Type level compiler yourself to be able to use Libra, or can you use any SCSS?
No, you do need to use the type level Scala compiler. I'm not quite sure what the intricacies are in actually including a library that uses the type level Scala compiler to use normal code, but the reason why I would say you need to use it for this is because in order to write your ops, if I go back to them, you're going to need to reference singleton types, right? And in order to do that, you need the type level Scala. Okay?
Actually, no, it's not strictly. No, because those singleton types, they exist in vanilla Scala. I mean, the only thing that the literal type stuff, well, not strictly true, but the main thing that the literal type stuff is doing is it's providing syntax for them. But if you can get hold of those singleton types any other way, like, for example, using Shapeless as witness, that should be, the types you get out of witness are the same types. So I think there's a pretty good chance, although it would be a little bit more verbose using vanilla Scala in the client code, that you can probably use that without... the only problem might be if you're using value of.
Yes.
That could be a problem.
Yes,
but I think the obstacles to using this without type level Scala are pretty small, actually.
Are there visual types in
Scala?
Yeah, the syntax will be
not most.
Are there any quirks in terms of Scala type inference or just compilation times?
Not that I found, actually, strangely enough. I think it depends how large your type signature would then get, right? If you want it to affect compilation times. In general, when I use this, it's really two or three different types in that list. So I've not seen it affect that. I guess one thing to note for Libra is that I've not shown it here, but Libra actually also uses Spire. It uses Spire so that when you want to add and multiply quantities, you can use the Spire additive semigroup, so you can use all Spire's types. So you can use rationals if you want. You don't just need to tie yourself down to doubles. And that may introduce more overhead than just using your vanilla doubles or floats.
Do you think it would be possible to extend this to non-integral exponents for the units?
I actually already have. So I'm actually using fractional exponents. If you look in the Libra code, I didn't show it here because it would be a lot more complicated to actually describe. But yes, if you want to see some interesting uses of induction, then you can go and look at my fractional exponents.
Crazy one. So something. Not complex. No. Maybe even crazier than that. So basically, you're doing linear algebra with types. There is something else that we know about that uses linear algebra with types, and that's this really cool different derivatives of a data type stuff that kind of Conrad wrote about. Suppose we could. Could you? I think we could actually. Work out a mechanism given a polynomial over types, compute the derivative using implicit resolution, and then somehow produce the type of a zipper over the data type that we've got. I mean that's kind of what we get out of this. Do you think that would be feasible?
It's something we could look at. You want to discuss it later?
Okay, I think that was a great last comment or question.
Thanks.
Thank you.
And the only thing that's left to say now is behind this door, there's a reception waiting. And at the back of the room, there are still some shirts left, and also some stickers left, and also some mugs left, which you can take. So sorry for the people who have hard won them during trivia. That's worthless now. Take them if you want. So see you at the reception.
Thank you, Mark.